Good evening. We will call the September 22nd, 2015, Methacton School Board meeting to order. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome back to a new school year. By way of announcements and executive session, I'd like to announce that there's audio and video recording of this meeting for the purposes of rebroadcasting. Also have several executive sessions to report. There was an executive session held on September 15th for matters of personnel involving an administrative employee. There was an executive session held on September 16th, 2015 for matters of personnel involving an administrative employee. And there was an executive session held immediately prior to this meeting for matters of personnel involving an administrative employee, for matters of litigation between the Methacton School District versus Worcester Township and certain neighboring residents before the PA Common Court of Pleas in Montgomery County, doc number 2015-00779, and a matter of litigation between Shenandell SWD 101 LLC and WNR 38 LLC versus the Board of Assessment Appeals of Montgomery County, Lower Providence Township, Montgomery County, and Methacton School District. And that doc number is 2006-31345. By way of attendance, all board members are present except Ms. Shackelford and Mr. Phillips. And I would like to now move on to recognition of guests and scheduled speakers. Dr. Zerbe.
Thank you, Mr. President. This evening, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Ryan Creedon, acting principal at
Dr. Zerbe, just let the record state that Mr. Phillips is present.
Good. Welcome, Mr. Phillips.
Thank you.
Acting principal, Mr. Ryan Creedon at Arcola to introduce the M Award presentations for Arcola, and then we will have that followed up by Ms. Judy Landis for M Awards for the high school. Again, these M Awards are from last school year, and we'll ask all board members before the presentation starts to please take seats in the audience. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ryan Creedon. I'm the acting principal at Arcola Intermediate School. I'm very pleased to be here this evening and recognize 49 current and former Arcola Intermediate School students for their outstanding achievement. The names of the students that you will see displayed in front will be receiving an M Award for attaining a minimum GPA of 93% during the 2014-2015 school year in all subjects, while also receiving nothing lower than a 90% in all subject areas during each individual marking period. The students must also receive effort ratings of satisfactory or better throughout the school year. These are all great achievements. At this time, I'd like to ask I knew I would get this wrong as I came up here. I didn't practice enough.
All they care is about their names.
That's right. I would like to ask all of last year's seventh grade students, current eighth grade students, got it right that time, To come to the two center, down the two center aisles, where you will be greeted and congratulated by a school board member. And as you come to the front, please gather up in front of the stage. Thank you.
This is how you learn to go through a receiving line.
Yeah, right. Congratulations.
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 The students standing in front of you understand the importance of hard work and doing their very best at whatever they set their minds to. Thank you, parents, for teaching and modeling these characteristics for your children. I am confident that each one of you will continue to achieve great things now and into the future. Keep setting your goals high, and you'll be amazed at what you will accomplish. I'm looking forward to meeting each one of you individually as I will be giving you your M Award in person over the next couple days before the end of the week. Let's give them a round of applause. At this time, I would like to ask last year's eighth graders, current ninth graders, to come down the two center aisles and be congratulated by a school board member. And again, as you come up to the front, please form a line in front of the stage. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Good job. Congratulations. They're high schoolers now. They don't want to do middle school. The rest of them are studying. I guess so. All right, let's give them a round of applause.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Judy Gallagher-Landis, and I am the principal at Methacton High School. It seems like every year that they transition in school, it gets a little bit harder. We try to keep them challenged, and they keep rising to that occasion, and that's a testament to the families that they come from and the hard work that they put in. Tonight, we are also here to recognize the students that are in our current 10th, 11th, and 12th. See, it's a number thing. Long day. Okay, so our current 10th, 11th, and 12th graders will be honored tonight. You can see from the names, we actually have a huge number of kids at the high school that have achieved a 93% GPA at the end of the year. So their entire year of classes, and they achieved a 93%. So at this time, we would like our current 10th graders, last year's 9th grade class, to come on down the same way, if you could use the two aisles. Shake the hands of our board and please line up in front of the stage.
Congratulations.
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 Each of our classes at the high school number approximately 410. That was the last count that I saw in several of our classes. So you can see that this is actually about, here is not necessarily, but those that have been honored with this award are approximately a quarter of that class that are achieving a 93% or better with high academic rigor. So congratulations. As they go up in grade level, their responsibilities seem to increase, so you'll notice that the numbers will dwindle down here, but not necessarily up on the list. So at this time, if we could please have this year's 11th grade class come down the two aisles and line up in front of the stage. Keep up the hard work. Thanks. And as they make their way back to their seats, if we could have this year's 12th graders, please come on down, same way. Again, I know that tonight we are actually competing with, I think, an orchestra rehearsal and all kinds of things that are going on. And of course, the holiday tomorrow is also having an impact. Again, a round of applause. A heartfelt congratulations to all the students who have achieved this award, and I look forward to seeing you guys and reading those names at graduation. So congratulations.
Okay, while the next item on the agenda for recognition of guests and scheduled speakers, we have item 5.2, the 2009 General Obligation Bond Refunding presentation from RBC, that'll be Mr. Scott Kramer, and from PFM, Mr. Glenn Willard. Would both you gentlemen please come forward?
Good evening. Also with us this evening is John Cox, who's your bond counsel from Rhodes & Son. You have a document at your station with a blue cover. We're going to talk from that. I'll just try to give you a brief executive summary. There's a series of 2009 bond issue that's been on the screen to be refunded. It has a call date in 2018, so we have to invest any bond proceeds to 2018, and that generates what's called negative arbitrage. You borrow money at 3% and you invest it at almost zero. So, you know, that detracts from the savings. So we've been watching that, and I think the administration was hoping we could put together a resolution that the board could adopt, what we call a parameters resolution, and then that would give us, the financing team, the flexibility to refund all or portions of this bond issue over the next couple of years. You may remember there's an IRS rule that if you issue less than $10 million in a calendar year, the bonds can be deemed as bank qualified and then you get a slightly better interest rate. So we've parsed things up in $10 million tranches historically here at Methacton. And this resolution would allow us to do the same as we go forward and look at analyzing the 2009 refunding. The other little addition we'd put to this is it gives us the ability, this resolution would give us the ability to consider doing a bank loan as well as a bond issue. And we try to evaluate if there's any savings from doing a bank loan versus doing a full-fledged bond issue. So all that would be contained in this resolution. So that's kind of a high-level summary of what we'd like to talk about. So if you want to look at page two, some of these items are mentioned here again, but we'll just sort of go down through that. The series of 09 is around $29 million. It has interest rates of 5.75 on average. We think we can refund this bond issue with interest rates in the twos and threes, so there will be some nice savings. In that center section, there's some discussion about the bank qualified rules that I talked about. And then down near the bottom are what we have as next steps. We discussed this with the Finance Committee a week or so ago. I think they asked us to come back and present this to you. Again, it's possible that we would do a transaction towards the end of this year, towards the end of 2015, that would settle in 2016. These bank qualified rules are based on a calendar year limit, not the school year limit. So, and then at that time, we just consider market conditions as to whether we want to do more of the refunding or not. And then also we need to keep our eye on any capital needs that the school district has because the 10 million rule would include any, you know, roof repairs or ESCO projects or anything like that. So as we go through time, we'll have to sort of on a parallel track, keep track of the refunding as well as your capital needs. Okay, so there's any number of possibilities of how this might play out over the next couple of years, but there's a little scenario at the bottom of page two. In terms of some numbers, if you go to the next page, right now on the right hand side of page three in the orange, sort of in about the middle there. It appears, based on current conditions, there's a little bit over $2 million of refunding savings. In the red, there's still $1 million of this negative arbitrage, so it's like a 2-to-1 ratio right now. I think when we looked at this 6 months ago, it was 50-50, so now it's improving. And you can see when we slide to option two, just by sliding some of this into the next different school year, we get up to $2.2 million, and potentially we can get to $2.6 million or so. All this changes as interest rates move around, but that's just a scenario of how this might lay out. And again, I think each time we would do one of these, we'd just sort of come up for air and look at interest rates and look at what the district sees in their long-range capital plan. So that's kind of a five-minute summary. I'll be happy to answer any questions or turn it over to Scott or John, if you guys have anything you'd like to say. Do you have any questions? I think in terms of a timeline, if you'd like us to proceed, we would put together the necessary resolution and be back at the end of October, I forget your meeting date, but like the end of October, and then that would be the voting meeting for the board to incur the resolution, and then that would be the last step that the board has to take in terms of approving the resolution.
Any questions? Mr. Pelicano?
So, Clay, could you just explain with respect to the different options? I mean, it may be a scenario where you could take one action. Rates might change. We may realize some savings, but not everything if rates change. But we will at least have that opportunity to make a decision to move forward one way or another. We're not locked in, right?
That's right. So this resolution would allow us to proceed as long as we meet certain minimum targets. We'd put that in probably at 3%. We could pick a higher number, but probably 3% is what we've historically used. And then it would be at the direction of the business office, and the board president would need to sign the purchase contract on the day of whenever that sale would be.
Additional questions? Anything else?
That's it. So if you'd like, give us some direction. We'd come back in a month or so.
This evening we brought this item before the board so that the entire board, at the recommendation of the Finance Committee, would have this material in front of them, would have the opportunity to ask questions. And we believe it's in the district's best interest to ask this finance team to come back to us in October with the parameters resolution and to address the board for action at that time. Is that something you'd like me to schedule and put on the agenda for the October, I believe, 27th meeting?
Unless anyone has any objection, I think the Finance Committee concurs and the administration is certainly supportive. Unless there's no objection, then we'll see you back here in about a month.
Okay, so the team will be back in a month.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That ends the presentations for this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Zerbe. Moving on to item number 6, public comment on board action items. Before we take public comment, there were some statements made at the last board meeting that accused the board of violating the Sunshine Law. So I'd like to have our solicitor make a public comment on that before we move to public comment on board action items.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I will go through a little bit of what had happened at the July board meeting. As you may recall, the board at that time did not take the final public comment that had only to do with the items that were not on the agenda. As a result of that, the board indicated through the president that those comments would be taken at a future meeting, and it was announced when that future meeting was, it being the next regular meeting of the board. As was clear, I think, from the matters that took place that evening, the time issue was such that the board was about ready to go into executive session, and we were ready to discuss a matter that ended up taking, I believe, about an hour or so for us to discuss, but really could have taken much longer had there been some questions from the board in that regard. It was a matter of litigation that was discussed that evening. The board president at that time had a couple of options. Obviously, we could have taken the public comment that evening, not had the executive session. We could have taken the public comment that evening and had the executive session at a later hour. The board president and the board chose not to do that. I think in some measure because of the fact that there were time considerations. I think the time considerations were the primary measure. In addition to that, people who were here may recall that there were 5 and not 9 members of the school board who were in attendance that evening. So that from a time standpoint, the decision of the board was to spend that time in a manner that it deemed to be appropriate, which was the executive session rather than the public comment. Now, no one missed any public comment at the next meeting. All of the public comment opportunities were there, and anything that could have been said on the 28th of July could also have been said at the August meeting. So there was no issue with regard to that. All of that is provided for in Pennsylvania's Sunshine Law. The Sunshine Law makes it very clear that when there are issues of time considerations, that the board has the right to not take public comment on those items that are not action matters on the agenda. And that was the only portion of the public comment section that was deferred. The other portion of the public comment, which was on matters of board action that evening, was handled in the normal course at the beginning of the meeting, as it always is. The Sunshine Law makes it clear that that decision is a decision of the board to be made, and the way that that is done in Methacton, if you look at the policies, power of the board is delegated to the chair, as it is in Robert's rules as well, with respect to the making of that decision. In the event that the board disagrees with the ruling of the chair, the procedure then is that the board as a whole has the right to vote to overrule the chair. But absent that, the way that the board acts is through the chair, as is normally the case in conducting business at each of our public meetings. So if you take a look at the policies of the district and combine that with the Sunshine Law, it's clear that the board acted properly and that the chair acted properly with respect to the deferral of the public comment on non-agenda items.
Thank you, Mr. Bartle. I'll now move on to item 6, public comment on board action items. If anyone would like to make public comment on the board action items that we're going to take action on tonight, please come forward. Please state your name and residence for the record, and please keep comments to 3 minutes.
So a question to start with, would this be an appropriate time?
Can you give your...
Sure, Larry Reich, Lower Providence Township. Would this be an appropriate time to address Mr. Bartle's comments, or would you prefer that wait for courtesy of the floor this evening?
Courtesy of the floor, since we're not going to take any action.
Very good.
Ashley Wilkerson from Audubon. I have a question about the announcements of the executive sessions that were mentioned earlier. Was there an executive session after the last board meeting on August 25th?
I was absent, so I have to ask.
There was.
There was?
Yes, there was.
Okay. Okay, so if you can get me details, I'll announce that. I was absent from that meeting, so I didn't have it on my list. Sorry about that.
Does nobody remember what it was about? Because I think everyone's here who was at that board meeting.
Do you remember, you, as the chair, do you remember what the board executive session was about that evening?
I can.
I do. I can. There were two matters discussed. There was a matter of personnel for an administrative matter, and there was a matter of litigation, which include...
Was the same matter you?
It was over the Shenandoah matter. Yeah, it was between Shenandoah and the Board of Assessment Appeals with Montgomery County and Lower Providence Township, docket number 2006-31345.
Okay, I guess my question then is that the chairman of the Lower Providence Township Republican Committee was observed to go back and appeared to join in that executive session, and so some of us were curious what matters were discussed that would involve him.
Can I?
Go ahead. Yeah, that wasn't fair.
No one else joined the executive session. I know that gentleman came to the back in the area, but he did not join the executive session.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Kim Aubrey Larson, East Lower Providence. I know it's been mentioned in the past that some of the various committees have not always posted their minutes, so I appreciate that there are minutes. attached to this meeting, to this agenda tonight. However, the property committee meeting on September 14th, I wanted to ask that there be a correction made to the minutes. It says that the meeting was called to order at 7:31 a.m., and the meeting actually didn't start until 7:45. Given the fact that those committee meetings are not recorded and we're relying on the minutes for the general public to know what happened, I think it's important that that be added in there. No disrespect to Mr. Phillips, but I believe that the reason was because Mr. Phillips was not present, and I think that that should be noted in the minutes.
Thank you.
Sorry, anyone else for public? Mr. Andrews?
John Andrews, Lower Providence. With regard to the list of bills, under the general fund on page one of those listings, there's a cost item for a capital campaign fundraiser. I don't understand why that should be a general fund dispersal. Perhaps the capital reserves, but not the general fund is for education, whereas the capital fundraiser is a, you know, it's a questionable activity. You may have it, and you may not even get enough returns to cover that cost. With regard to the property committee meeting on September 14th, relative to the status on the Fields project at that time, it was commented by the Dr. Zerbe that the auxiliary field was almost done, had a temporary occupancy permit, but that there was a disagreement on the infill, so that the field was not in use. Now, earlier I had witnessed a spreading of black crumb rubber on that field. Yet back in May, we had contracted for green-coated black crumb rubber. So then the, as an attachment to the agenda for tonight's meeting, is a printed property committee meeting for September 14th, where it said that Dr. Zerbe and Mr. Fretz updated the committee on that athletic improvement project and that we have begun using the auxiliary field for practices and games. So my notes disagree with those minutes. While it's not a voting item, I think that we deserve an explanation as to what happened. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional public comment, Mr. Bickelman?
Joe Bickelman from Audubon. I looked at the capital reserve disbursements and the bond fund disbursements from the Emmaus Bond Fund. I think it might be helpful if the board requests the administration to do a receipts and disbursements for the capital reserve fund, and below that show the accumulating costs per each project. That way you can keep track of each project's cost, and the public could see what each project, you know, what the total is at any time. You can even list a budget figure too. So that would be a helpful report, just receipts and disbursements, and below that show the project costs. I have a question on the bills list also. It's on page 6. There's a disbursements to Kelly's Sports Limited for $5,627.65. And the description is air horn with air canister, wrestling cap. I just wanted to know what that was. I went to the Kelly's website and tried to dial up some things about that using those words as a search, and I didn't see anything on their website. And I wanted to know if quotes were obtained for an item that's $5,600, you know, kind of like shop around various vendors for that product, whatever it is. I don't know what it is. Another question on the disbursements. On page 5, there is a disbursements to TD Card Services I guess that's the credit card company of the district, and it's for administrative retreat food, and it's for $446.69. I think we see the TD card services as the vendor that we're paying, but there should be some way to distinguish who we charged it to, you know, if it's a restaurant, if it's a catering service. You know, I'd like to see exactly who we're paying for that food for the administrative retreat. It's for $446.69. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Andrea Reese, Lower Providence. I noticed that it looks like you're approving the math curriculum and instructional support teachers, the one for K to 4 and the one to 5 to 9. I sat through the presentation at the Education Committee, and I do understand what those positions are, and it looks like they're effective to be determined. I assume those people, their replacement needs to be found for their classroom position. I was just hoping that if they are filled with long-term substitutes from STS, that those people are given appropriate benefits and sick days and things like that, because as of now, they're not. So for an entire year, those classrooms are going to be covered by, I assume, STS employees. And although I feel these positions may be needed in the light of the explanation, I'm still a little iffy on the explanation, because they are listed as teachers versus coaches, but they don't spend time instructing students. I would just ask that you look into their replacements, whether they're long-term subs or contract positions, and that those teachers be treated fairly, since they will be instructing many of our students.
Thank you. Additional public comment? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to item number 7, the appointment of new student board representatives and the administration of the oath of office. So, do I take a motion to approve this, I assume?
Yeah, and then we do the...
Yeah, the swearing in. Okay. So under item 7.1, I'll ask for a motion to approve the appointment of Methacton High School juniors. All right, I'm not going to go through this again and say your name wrong.
Fibo?
Yeah. Gupta? And Tara Mita? As student board representative to the Board of School Directors for a term of 2 years. This would be effective for the 2015-2016 school year and then the following year. May I have a motion? Ms. Woodring, is there a second? Ms. Barone, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? I'll assume there's none against. Unanimous, 8-0. Congratulations.
Welcome.
Now, if you want to come up front, I will administer the oath of office. Yeah, one at a time. So I'll read this, repeat after me, and afterwards you fix your signature, I'll fix mine, the superintendent will fix his, and then you will officially be sworn in as a school board director. So please repeat after me. I do by solemnly swear.
I do by solemnly swear
that I will support, obey, and defend.
That I will support, obey, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of this Commonwealth.
And the Constitution of this Commonwealth.
And that I will discharge.
And that I will discharge
the duties of the office.
The duties of the office
of student representative.
Of student representative
to the board.
To the board
with fidelity.
With fidelity.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I forgot to right hand up. Ready? Please repeat after me. I do by solemnly swear.
I do by solemnly swear.
That I will support, obey, and defend.
That I will support, obey, and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of this Commonwealth.
And the Constitution of this Commonwealth.
And that I will discharge the duties.
And I will discharge the duties.
Of the Office of Student Representative.
Of the Office of Student Representatives.
Of the Board.
Of the Board.
With fidelity.
With fidelity.
Congratulations. Okay, you are rightly in. Moving on to item number 8, reports. Finance Committee, Mr. Pelicano.
Thanks, Mr. President. The Finance Committee met on Tuesday, September 15th, in the Farina Education Center. All members were present except for Mrs. Shackelford. There was 5 items on the agenda overall. The first item had to do with a presentation by the Berkheimer Group. Mr. Hunt from Berkheimer gave us a pretty detailed summary of the various collection procedures that Berkheimer does for the district with respect to for earned income tax and for the per capita tax. Some questions that were taken on what was provided by various townships, et cetera, in that regard. And I think generally we came away with a good feeling regarding the thoroughness of the collection procedures, and but we'll continue to look for improving that over time if needed. The second item on the agenda was the item you heard about earlier today from Mr. Willard and Mr. Kramer regarding the bond refinancing, so I won't spend a lot of time on that, but it was the committee's recommendation that we move forward to present that here tonight. The third item was the monthly financial report. Should we get a monthly set of financial reports from the business office that gives us revenue and expenditure information for the various departments and schools and what have you. We looked at that. There was various questions entertained with respect to where we were spend-wise over the course of the year to date, and I think Mr. Whitelow satisfactorily answered all the questions. The next item on the agenda was the 16-17 budget calendar. Dr. Zerbe and Mr. Whitelow presented that calendar and explained a couple options that we had to us with respect to passing a resolution either with the index, accepting that, or to seek exceptions. There was some dialogue that occurred with respect to, given this budget stalemate in Harrisburg, whether we might want to give ourselves some flexibility on which way we go there. I think the committee agreed that at this point we want to continue to monitor that closely. Hopefully we'll get to that budget resolution shortly, and then we can decide maybe on what the best course of action is in that regard. And lastly, Mr. Whiteleather presented some information on the district-wide feasibility study and the long-range capital plan. This work was, this RFP was recently approved by the property committee, so it was really more of an updater for us to understand what was going on with that. As that takes place and crystallizes, Finance Committee will get more information, because as the projects are determined over time, obviously there's a cost with those, and we have to consider those costs from a Finance Committee perspective. So more to come on that. Various items were brought up on the courtesy of the floor discussions around debt financing, surrender certifications, some minutes, some transfer taxes, feasibility study, whether we should do that in-house or outsource that, budget timeline, long-range capital plan, and the feasibility study RFP. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, Mr. Pelicano. Property Committee, Mr. Phillips.
Since I was absent, I don't know if Herb would like to do an update or Dave.
Sure, I'd be glad to. We had a property committee meeting. Let's see here, on September 14th, 7:30 a.m. We had a couple presentations. The first one was from Schneider Electric. It was a project update. He presented a handout on what's going on with what they're working on. One of the biggest noticeable things they did is worked on the gym, the high school gym, where the lighting levels were approximately 20-foot candles before they started, and now there are at least 50-foot candles in the center of the gym. So the gym is noticeably brighter. That also, with the combination of repainting the walls as well, has also brightened that up considerably. LED upgrades are going to start, probably started by now, mid-December they'll be done. And that's LED upgrades throughout the district. Rebates for the gym were submitted and approved by PICO, and those rebates will be substantial. We don't have the dollar amounts yet. Also, they did a construction update regarding the fields. The stadium turf fields was ongoing. And also, too, I did check the minutes, and there is an error in the minutes, so we'll correct that when we get to that point. But I'm going to correct it now in my report. The aux field was not being used at the time of the meeting. It had an temporary occupancy permit, but we were waiting for the infill issue to be resolved. Shortly after that, I believe the field was started to be used. I don't have that date down when the first teams got on that field, but on the 16th, so 2 days later. The stormwater basin is being redesigned from an infiltration basin to a retention basin. So we need some re-engineering on that, and that work is ongoing as well. And also, briefly, was discussed a long-term capital plan update, and a handout was sent out throughout the meeting. Long-term plan is being worked on. What to bring into what we're going to bring in is an architectural consultant on developing this plan, and this is an extensive plan that would literally attack, you know, focus on every aspect of the district, every single building, everything. And the committee did approve for an RFP to go out and get some idea on pricing on what this would cost us. So that's the end of my report for the property committee.
Thank you, Mr. Roth. Do you want to continue on Human Resources Committee?
Absolutely. Let me switch pages here. We had an HR committee meeting. The latest one was on 9/15. I double-checked the minutes on that as well, and there is a correction to be made on that. We did start at approximately 7:31, according to my notes, ended at 8:30. Two things that we'll talk to and that are in the on the board agenda for this evening is an ISSS position. It's a supplemental contract with it's an extra duty contract to really add some software support to the district. And if you could touch on that real quick, just a little bit, with that ISSS position.
We're just adding one to the high school for several initiatives that are taking place this year. It's a one-year position that we're looking to get extra support for all four grades. So we're asking for just one additional ISSS for this year.
And that was approved by the HR committee to come to the board tonight. Second was with two math positions. And they are also on the board agenda tonight to relate to get stronger with the PA Corps to find out, really start analyzing the data. And that was also advised by the Education Committee, too. It was passed through that to go through the HR. That's it basically for my report. Thank you.
Thank you. I think actually the minutes are right that the HR Committee did start at 6:30 to 7:30 and Finance started 7:30 to 8:30.
That's correct.
Okay, moving on to 8.4, Education Committee, Ms. Hackett.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Education Committee met on September the 8th in the Farina Center. All members of the committee were present, including Ms. Shackelford, who was present by phone, as well as staff members, Ms. Katona, Dr. Angstadt, Mr. Sosnovic, Ms. Bonder, Dr. Kokenauer. The first thing we heard was from Ms. Katona that the Office of the Governor announced a one-year pause on SPP scores for based on tests for grades lower than high school. So there is an impact on teacher evaluation from SPP scores, so we do not know what that impact will be yet. We have not yet received the scores for the testing performed in spring of 2015, but I think they're due very soon. Dr. Anstack gave the committee a report on the work of the home and school visitor with all of the activities that she is involved with. truancy, poverty, homelessness needs, temporary homeschool needs, accessing available service to aid students and their families. And then we had a technology update from Mr. Sosnovic, who talked about four different areas of technology in the district. The first being GAFE, G-A-F-E, Google Apps for Education, which is being expanded into the elementary schools this year. And we will be having a parent education night as well. Another thing that is happening is libraries are being transformed. This started at Arcola, then moved to the high school. It's now underway in Skyview, and next they're going to move into the elementary schools. And then there's MyMSD, which is the student portal, so that they have an easy way of accessing all of the materials that they can use while they're in the district. And a student advisory council is being developed. And online assessments will also be taking place. Mrs. Katona reported on JumpStart, which is a program that we ran in the summertime. We ran it this year in 2015, and there were 25 students participating in that program. It's designed to provide a smoother entry to kindergarten for children who may need a boost. Dr. Kochenauer reported on the AP testing, AP classes that students take, and the SAT and ACT participation. She noted that the AP classes is growing and the scores continue to improve. And on the SATs and ACTs, scores are down slightly. Ms. Katona presented information on the proposed addition of two math curriculum and support teachers, one for K to 4 and one for 5 to 9, and the committee approved recommending these positions from the Education Committee perspective. And Mr. Sosnovic gave some information on the enrollment report, which was attached to the agenda for anybody who was at that meeting. There were questions about classes that have been capped and the number of students assigned to schools other than their home schools. And Ms. Shackelford reminded us that she had sent some information on mindfulness and its positive role on the life of students and what were we doing in Methacton for that. And one of the things that Dr. Angstadt commented was that some of the elementary schools participate in something called the Chicken Fat Song at the beginning of the day, which gives the children the opportunity to bond each day. And the other schools are doing other techniques. And in courtesy of the floor, there were some comments on the role of the math support teachers, AP exams, library changes, free and reduced price lunches, and truancy, opting out of testing. And there were kudos to the staff for the work on back-to-school nights. The meeting adjourned at 9:20. That's my report.
Thank you. Communications, Mr. McFarland.
The Communications Committee has been undergoing some reorganization, did not meet in September. The next scheduled meeting is October 6th, which we'll meet at that time.
Thank you. Policy Committee, Ms. Woodring.
Thank you. Policy Committee met on September 9th. On our agenda for that meeting was about nine different policies. The minutes are attached to the agenda, so I won't go over them one by one. The discussion during that meeting did not lead to any first reads for tonight's agenda. The 10 first reads that we included on the August agenda, school board agenda, will roll now on this agenda to the second read. And I would just like to remind everyone that due to a scheduling conflict, our October meeting was moved to October 20th. That's it.
Thank you. Intermediate unit, Ms. Hackett.
There was a meeting of the intermediate unit on August the 26th, 2015. Which was a meeting to handle many routine things. The one thing that I found that was not routine was the announcement that the intermediate unit has enough cash that it will be able to function until November. should the budget not be approved in the state, which is a bit of a scary thought. That's my report.
Thank you. Moving on to North Monco Technical Career Center, Mr. Phillips and Ms. Woodring.
Thank you. The JOC met last evening. Some of the items that we discussed were, first of all, I guess we heard about the center's need for a new roof. So we'll have more details to develop over the next few months on that project. Of course, it's complicated because it's not one, it's one building, but the five sending districts all have to weigh in. So we'll have some more details coming our way about that. We ratified the Tech Center CBA for teachers. Probably the most significant change is in the area of health benefits and the number of personal days versus emergency days per year. The bargaining unit had ratified that contract prior to last night's meeting. We acknowledged the two gold medal winners at the National Skills Competition that I mentioned last meeting. They attended that competition this past June in Kentucky. Both students were present. We had a young man from PV and a young lady from North Penn who combined to make up the mechatronics team. They commented on how much they enjoyed the opportunity and grew from the experience. October 1, the JOC was invited to lunch, and the cafeteria will officially open to the public on October 7th. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Student board representatives, I'm sure you both have a detailed report ready to go.
All right. So, in sports, Methacton students continue to excel. Jeff Kirschenbaum and the boys' cross-country team continues his season undefeated in dual meets. He currently has the fourth best time in the state of Pennsylvania with the 15:45 for a 5K race. He's coming off of a win at Bulldog Invitational along with a team win from Methacton. The girls' cross-country team continues its strong start with a current 2-1 Pac-10 record, good for second place in the Pac-10. Also, the team won at Bulldog Invitational. Furthermore, the girls' field hockey team continues to be led by Madeline Aldifer, Emily Sayre, and Sarah Park, all college commits. The boys' golf team is currently tied for first place with consistently strong performances by Kyle Vance and Daniel Rieger. Also, the boys' soccer team inaugurated the turf field with a 5-0 win. Methacton's girls' tennis team is being led by Mihaela Codrinu, who is second in the state for her age group, and they also boast a 4-0 Pac-10 record, which is currently first in the Pac-10. The junior varsity and varsity teams consistently display strong performances. Finally, libero Claire Miller shows great consistency with leadership for the Methacton girls volleyball team.
Before I start, I just wanted to say thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here to represent the student body. It's a privilege. So there's a few changes that students met when we came in first day of school, and students have been loving the changes, especially the library, which has been updated with a corner that allows students to have a quiet space with no distractions. Electrical outlets have also been installed at some tables to encourage students to participate in the Bring Your Own Device, or BYOD program. Also, a couple of cafeteria lines have been installed in the high school commons that currently serve breakfast to students until 9:30. And we are also planning to have later students in study hall will be able to purchase snacks there. So there's a lot of students love those changes. And finally, the prom theme for this year is officially A Night in Venice. And the junior class of 2017 is working diligently on planning it. And lastly, while details are still being worked out, the high school has decided to incorporate a parade into this year's homecoming event. Thank you.
Thank you. Communications, Ms. Lynch.
Thank you, Mr. President. So I have two very exciting events, as I knock over the podium. I have two very exciting events to talk to the board about tonight. One is the October 3rd Warrior Pride Education Foundation for the Methacton Community Beef and Beverage event that will be held at St. Helena's Roman Catholic Church. This event to benefit the Warrior Pride campaign will incorporate dinner, dancing, prizes, and more, and tickets are on sale on our website right now. Also, as Ms. Maida mentioned, there is the October 24th homecoming, which will incorporate not only a homecoming parade, which is an inaugural event for the Methacton High School community, but a ribbon-cutting ceremony for the grand opening of the Methacton High School fields. So we'll start with a parade at 9:30 a.m. at Eagleville Elementary School, and we'll parade 1.2 miles to Methacton High School, where they will cut a ribbon on the campus for the fields, and we'll have a celebration of a community day on the Methacton High School auxiliary field so that our community members can see and feel and experience those fantastic resources that the board has been so kind as, and the community has been so kind as to support for us and for our students. The parade will connect to Lower Providence, to Worcester Township. All of our elementary schools and other schools will participate, as well as each class. There will be floats, so it'll be a lot of fun and excitement. And the Arcola and Methacton High School marching bands will lead that parade and participate in a joint parade, a joint marching band together in a display of Methacton pride. Thank you.
Thank you. Finally, Superintendent's Report, Dr. Zerbe.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm pleased to report that we got off to a great school year. Students are excited, staff are energized, and we, as a Methacton School District, are poised to have another great school year filled with many accomplishments. The start of a great school year cannot be better displayed by recognizing one of our teachers. It gives me great pleasure, and I'm very proud to report that Methacton High School teacher Bruce Outland was recently chosen by the Montgomery County Science Teachers Association for the 2014-15 Exemplary Teacher Award, High School Division. This award honors science teachers across the county for their contributions to science education in the lives of their students, schools, and communities. In being recognized, Mr. Outland has demonstrated mastery of his profession, sincerity, and dedication towards his work, his students, and his colleagues. We appreciate the work of Mr. Outland. While as superintendent, I'm pleased to mention all the great things that happened in the district and pleased to recognize students as we did here this evening. Unfortunately, there are times when I need to tell you things that don't go so well, and so just bear with me as I talk this evening about busing and transportation. The Methacton School District and First Student Incorporated are a transportation vendor, take an active role in providing safe and efficient busing services to the Methacton community as our top priority. While I'm quick to share many of the great things regarding our district, I must also share some things that didn't go so right this school year. Since the beginning of the 2015-16 school term, our parents and our students have experienced numerous transportation issues. While most of these issues have been resolved, I regretfully recognize that several of the issues lingered far too long and that my staff's communication with parents was far less than what I or our parents have come to expect. While some transportation issues are inherent in the start of a school year, the quantity and rate of speed which we addressed and communicated them was not typical and shall not happen again. By the second week of school, the transportation issues became rather apparent as calls escalated to my office, but we put additional measures in place. We took appropriate steps in terms of additional temporary help to fix the timing and routing issues and to man the telephone to take a greater number of calls of parents and their concerns. Having shared all this, I sincerely apologize to anyone who had experienced transportation issues at the beginning of the school term. I want you to know that I value our relationship that we have with our parents, and I appreciate your patience through all of this. We will continuously monitor and make improvements as necessary. I'm on another happier note, I can talk to you about the Fields Project. I'm pleased to also announce that on September 16th, as previously semi-discussed here at the table, the auxiliary field was released to the athletic director and the high school principal for use by students. That's quite an accomplishment. While we've been behind schedule since the start of the construction project, by all means, this project is significantly meaningful for our community and for all of us involved. The Warrior field hockey team and the girls soccer team enjoyed the first ever practice on the field, and while on September 17th, the boys varsity soccer team celebrated their first victory on the field in a 5-0 rout of Perkiomen Valley. And I just, you know, want to tell you that on the 16th, when I saw the field hockey and then the soccer team hit the field, you would imagine, well, they would be using the sticks to hit the ball or kicking the ball. No. They were laying in the field doing snow angels. And that just tells you how excited these student athletes are to finally get access to something that has really been a topic in this community for quite some time. And I thank everyone that's been involved to help bring it to a reality for these children and for children 30 to 40 plus years in the future. Both the field hockey and boys soccer team played games this week, and the excitement of these games is not to be missed. I encourage everyone, all our Warrior fans, to visit the athletic website and try to fit a game into your schedule. Other aspects of the project continue as we near completion. Construction is almost finished on the restroom facility, with final inspections due at the end of this week, with a punch list items to shortly follow thereafter. The stadium turf is installed, and infill material and sand are being applied this week. The track resurfacing remains on schedule with a substantial completion of October 2nd, 2015. Plans are underway for review to address concerns with the large stormwater basin and infiltration on the district property. We plan to bring those proposals before the property committee at their October meeting, along with other updates on change orders. On a disappointing note related to the fields, it troubles me that we are nearing completion of this project without lights. While I remain confident that we will have lights, and I mean basically lights that have safe illumination levels as we need and we've recommended, I can honestly tell you it would be much, much better in terms of cost and usage if this decision was finalized. The issue remains in the Court of Common Pleas, but however, I promise you, a day will come with great excitement. Just please be patient with me and allow us to get this done to provide our students, our athletes, our musicians, and our youth programs an opportunity to practice and play on safely lit fields. The next item I have for the board and the public is, I just want to provide an update, if you will, allow me, on PSSA and actions that we're taking to address some math concerns that we have. On August 13, 2015, I sent a school messenger notification to parents of students going into grades 4 through 9 and placed that same message on the district website regarding the PSSA results. As mentioned in that notification, the Pennsylvania Department of Education notified school districts that performance results on the Pennsylvania School Assessment PSSA test administered in 2015 declined statewide. Then again, just a few weeks ago, I communicated with those same parents as a follow-up and sharing that the parents will soon receive individualized student reports. While parents have been receiving these reports annually, this year's report will also include a letter from the Pennsylvania Secretary of Education, Pedro Rivera, who will provide additional explanation related to this year's scores. You should expect to receive these reports and the letter from Dr. Rivera this week. We continue to recognize PSSA tests as a single measure of student achievement. On a daily basis, our administrators, teachers work together to engage Methacton students in meaningful work in order to provide them with the best education. As we move forward, we will implement change to improve student performance on this test, as well as make improvements to positively impact our students' individualized growth and all-around development. One such recommendation for change is found on the agenda this evening. We are seeking the board's approval on job descriptions and hires for math curriculum and instruction support teachers, one for grades K through 4 and one for grades 5 through 9. These two positions are recommended for 1 year and are designed to use student performance data, knowledge of our curriculum and instructional materials, and knowledge of PSSA and PA Common Core to assist our Director of Curriculum Instruction and Assessment with formulating actions that will address areas of weakness and support the alignment of our math curriculum in grades K through 9. there have been a number of actions that we've taken to strengthen the curriculum, instruction, and assessment in math, including the implementation of classroom diagnostics, or more referred to as commonly referred to as CDTs. These online tests are aligned with the PA Common Core standards and are diagnostic assessments that teachers use to guide student progress and skill development. In addition to that, we implemented a pilot program last year in grades 5 and 6, which led to a grades 5 and 6 having new mathematics resources to start the 15-16 school year off to deliver the math curriculum this year. We also, last year, had our 8th grade math teachers participate in the Montgomery County Intermediate Unit's Math Design Collaborative, which helps teachers throughout the county in building strategies related to instruction and assessment. We will continue this practice for a cohort of teachers in grade 7 at Methacton. Along the same lines, the high school will be using a new assessment system through Edmentum. Edmentum will be geared towards students who have not completed the Keystone results or demonstrated to be proficient in that test. These assessments are aligned with the PA Core, and teachers will use those results to inform instruction. Many of these actions are similar to those in our neighboring districts that face the similar problem that we do with the decline in scores. For instance, we know other districts from around the county are involved in the PA Institute for Instructional Coaching that's run through the Montgomery County Intermediate Unit. Last year, there were about 60 instructional coaches participating in this program to strengthen the area of math. We plan to engage in this program given the approval to hire the two math instructional support positions this evening. In addition, there's many districts also utilize CDTs to gather ongoing formative assessment data on students and have drilled into the data to inform their curriculum. While we've made some adjustments to our curriculum, our resources and assessments, the math curriculum and instruction support teachers will provide the needed focus and support to implement the needed change and to assist our teachers. The next item I want to just address with the board and the public is on school consolidation update. The school consolidation committee process is continuing with meetings scheduled for Wednesday, September 23rd, to hear responses from Thompson Associates on capacity questions proposed by the committee. Once the committee hears these responses and is satisfied with them, we will decide the best method of sharing this information out with the rest of the public. In addition to addressing capacity, I am holding vendor presentations on October 1st at the high school LGI, which are open to the public. The vendor presentations will begin at 6:30 p.m. and end at approximately 8 p.m. The purpose of these presentations is to help me determine the vendor to recommend to the board of school directors for the specific purpose of a second enrollment report and as well as to secondarily, if needed, to address any redrawing of boundary lines if it comes to that point. This way, we can determine, by having a second enrollment report, we can determine if we have a reasonable level of reliability in the enrollment projections before moving forward with any further discussions on school consolidation. The secondary purpose of the presentations is to determine that if needed, the tools, processes, and capabilities of vendors to utilize enrollment projection work that they've completed to assist the district in potentially redrawing of attendance areas. Now, just to be clear, we've asked these vendors for a two-phase approach in that we will engage and compensate the vendor first with work only on completing the enrollment projections. And only then, if needed, based on review of those enrollment projections and the comparison of those enrollment projections against the enrollment projections provided by Pell, will I be able to make a recommendation to the board to move forward with any further actions. I believe that the next steps will be centered on the comparison of these enrollment projections and will likely lead into continuing with the process or some other determination. Ultimately, these projections on enrollment are critical to our decision making. We received proposals whereby the School Consolidation Committee heard four presentations, of which one was eliminated, bringing three forward for members of the community and me to hear on October 1st. I will take comments following those presentations, but with no expectation of answering questions either at the presentation or following them. My plan is simply, you know, use the information gathered not only from my view of the presentations, but from information that I hear back from the Consolidation Committee, as any information that you also provide from, I hear from the public, to render a conclusion and then to make a recommendation to the board. I may have to call a special meeting in October to get vendor approval in order to move forward with the secondary and second enrollment report. Lastly, I just want to thank members of the School Consolidation Committee for their volunteer time in helping me over the past several months. Lastly, I want to give a quick update on strategic planning. I'm leading a comprehensive strategic planning effort in the Methacton School District. Strategic planning is an organizational activity that is used to set priorities, focus energy and resources, strengthen operations, and to ensure that the stakeholders are working towards common goals aligned around intended results. Strategic planning is an effort that produces fundamental decisions and actions that shape and guide what an organization is, what it wants to become, and how it can move in a direction commensurate with the community needs and desires. I formed a strategic planning steering committee. This committee consists of 12 representative stakeholders, including students, parents, business persons, teachers, and administrators, who will assist me with selecting a facilitator to assist in leading the strategic planning process. This steering committee will advise me on a timeline and activities, and also suggest volunteers that might be helpful in this process. Our goal is to bring a strategic planning document before the community by April 30th of 2016. I will have Ms. Lynch, our communications coordinator, establish a section on our website to keep members of the community apprised of our progress. And that ends my report for this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Zerbe. We'll now move on to item number 9, board meeting minutes. Can I have a motion to approve the board meeting minutes of the meeting held on August 25th, 2015, as attached? Ms. Hackett, is there a second? Mr. Pelicano, any discussion? Is there any adjustment we need to make based on any of the comments made tonight?
I'm not understanding.
Okay. And no further comments. All those in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? Board meeting minutes from August 25th are approved. I'm abstaining due to my absence and assume that Mr. Phillips is as well. Moving on to item number 10, fiscal items. Mr. Whiteleather.
Thank you. A couple items on for this evening. The first item is our monthly list of bills as reviewed by Finance Committee, on for your approval. Next item is our monthly treasurer's report, as well reviewed by Finance Committee, on for your approval this evening. And lastly, approval of establishment of a student activity account for the class of 2019 is on for your approval this evening. That concludes my report.
So I'll ask for a motion to approve item 10 as listed, as presented. Mr. Pelicano, is there a second? Mr. Roth, any discussion? Mr. McFarland?
Just briefly, we went over this in some detail at the Finance Committee, but I just wanted to comment and ask Mr. Whiteleather to confirm just another public comment that was made earlier, that the Methacton School District has sufficient funds without state funding to go well into the next calendar year. Is that correct?
Yes, we did a cash flow analysis based upon what we anticipate with an escalation factor, obviously, for year-to-year expenditures. And we project sufficient cash flow through May of 2016, if necessary. So that gives us, obviously, some breathing room. Hopefully, we won't have to go that far without a state budget.
Thank you. Additional comment? Further discussion? Ms. Woodring?
Yeah, I just had two questions for Stuart. I noticed on the list of bills that we are paying licensing fees to the Lancaster-Lebanon IU number 13, and I just wondered if you might help me understand that. And then my second comment or question is that I noticed that we've got some dissertation associated fees for Immaculata, and I just wondered if we have some staff perhaps ready to defend a dissertation.
Your first question is for software throughout the district. We purchased through the Lancaster-Lebanon Intermediate Unit for software for the district. And the second question on the dissertation, yes, we do have staff who are going through their doctoral program, and tuition, as you have seen on the bill list, is reflective of that stage of their coursework.
Great, thank you.
Any additional comments, questions, discussion? Okay, seeing none, I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor? Opposed? 8-0, unanimous. Personnel items, Mr. Harney.
Yes, this evening we have two job descriptions for your approval. As Dr. Zerbe discussed earlier, the K-4 and the 5-9 math curriculum instruction support teachers. We have one resignation professional. We have one resignation classified. Two employment professional. We have five employment classified for this evening. We have three employment long-term substitute classified. We have two change of status, and those again are referred, they are the K-4 and the 5-9 math curriculum instruction support teachers. We have two compensated professional development leaves for your approval, one uncompensated leave classified. We have nine supplemental contracts for your approval. We also have two additions to our classified substitute list. We're asking for your approval on our volunteer list for this month. We have 12 advisements for your approval. I'd like to make one minor adjustment to number 12, if I could. It's actually for Sean Weston from Skyview / Arcola Intermediate School to Arcola Intermediate School and Audubon Elementary. We did not have the Skyview in there originally.
Thank you, Mr. Harney. Does anyone want to take any of these separately?
I just have a question on the job descriptions. Job descriptions?
For the number one?
Yes.
All right, let's take that separately then. Any other? We'll take item number one separately. Any other? Okay. Then I will ask for a motion to approve items 11.2 through 11.15. Ms. Woodring, is there a second? Ms. Barone, any discussion? Mr. Roth.
Just a quick point note that I discovered on the HR committee minutes that under 11.12.1, approve the supplemental contracts, there was a typo in the minutes of that last ISSS person. In the minutes, it said 29.16 is the amount of the salary, but it's actually 21.96 in line with the rest of them. I just wanted to clear that up so there's no confusion. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional comments or discussion? Okay, there's a motion and a second. All those in favor? Opposed? 8-0. All right, item 11.1. Mr. Pelicano, you have a question?
Yeah, just a simple question. I apologize, Mary, for not being able to get to you today on this, but just on the qualifications, I saw, you know, in the qualifications section, I guess four lines down, evidence of success in working with adult learners. I saw that in both of them. I just wanted to understand that. It just kind of stuck out to me, given the position, is why that was a necessity.
The position is, again, first and foremost, looking at data, and then to help teachers understand, first get the data into teachers' hands in an efficient manner, and then help them work with that data in terms of how instruction is delivered, what types of resources they might use, et cetera. And so, in other words, it isn't somebody who will sit and just work, you know, one-on-one with students. It will be people who need to also be able to work with teachers and administrators.
So can I have a motion to approve item 11.1, the job descriptions as attached for the K-4 and 5-9 math curriculum and instruction support teacher? Ms. Hackett, in a second. Mr. Pelicano, any further discussion? Mr. McFarland.
Sorry, just another couple of quick questions. I just want to make sure I understand in the job description where it says that the applicant must be holding a currently contracted position. What does that mean? Does that mean that they're working as an educator somewhere? Is that what that means?
It means it, because it's a teacher on assignment position, it's coming from the ranks of our teachers. Mr. Harney, is that?
That is correct.
And then on the, because the assistance is for multiple grades, in the case of 5 to 9, they'd be moving within 3 buildings. Would that be a minority of their work? Would they spend more time in data analysis and less time in movement, or would you think most of that would be between the different schools?
More than likely, initially, they'll be working more with the data to pore over it, understand it, probably get out, work with the administrators in the buildings, work with the math coordinators in the buildings to identify what those very specific areas are that we need more work in. And then after that, they would probably be out and about in the buildings more so.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Additional questions, comments, discussion? Okay, seeing none, can I have a, we have a motion and a second. I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor? Opposed? 8-0. And that is personnel items. Thank you. Moving on to number 12, curriculum and programs. Ms. Katona.
Okay, there is nothing listed as an action item this evening. However, just two quick things. First of all, thank you for approving those positions. I do believe they will be very helpful to us. And the other is, I just wanted to give you a very brief overview of our beginning of the year professional development activities, because many of these, many of the focus areas are going to continue throughout the remainder of the year. So first of all, simply on Monday the 31st, again, this was a little different this year, starting before Labor Day, so teachers came in Monday and Friday. And Monday the 31st, these activities were building-based with faculty and department meetings, as well as new student orientations. The principals and teacher and principals and teachers worked together to coordinate what those orientations would be for their new students. Then on Friday the 4th, we began with a welcome here at Arcola to all staff, and that included music from our high school band, which got everybody revved up. Afterwards, teachers from the K-4 buildings moved to Eagleville for an overview of the focus areas for the year, and then attended sessions to receive pertinent information related to math work that was accomplished during the summer that involved some formative assessments, and ELA information related to specific instructional practices. Skyview has begun work toward a focus on helping all students become critical readers and writers across all subject areas. And they held sessions related to that topic. Arcola teachers were focused on collaborative work in their grade levels according to needs based on their team, department, and co-teaching needs. And the high school began its focus on assessment literacy. This is a process through which teachers are assisted in reviewing their assessments and building them so they require different depths of knowledge, including a demonstration of analytical thinking. Arcola will also begin to engage in this professional development beginning in October. And so, as I said, we will continue these focus areas along with offerings in instructional technology throughout the year. And I want to mention as well that MCIU has been very helpful in assisting us with some of our workshops.
Great, thank you. Item number 13, policy, Dr. Zerbe.
Thank you, Mr. President. On the docket for this evening is item 13.1, second reading for 10 policies. That'll be policy 113, 116, 127, 137, 138, 212, 323, 338, 338.1, and 918. Since this is a second reading, I just want to bring your attention to policy number 338.1, which was added from the first reading to the second reading, which included that, and I'll read the language directly, requests for professional development leave shall be submitted with detailed plan to the superintendent no later than 60 days prior to the start of the requested leave. So the later than 60 days puts a time frame around the request so that it just doesn't occur prior to, you know, a day or two prior to the start of a school year. It allows us to have some flexibility in determining how we move forward with those leaves. And that's all I have for item 13.
Thank you. So since these are second readings, we'll be voting on these tonight. Is there a motion to, so does anyone want to take any of these separately? Okay. Can I have a motion to approve item 13.1 as presented? Ms. Woodring, is there a second? Mr. McFarland, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Opposed? 8-0. Very good. Moving on to other, Dr. Zerbe, gifts and donations.
Thank you. It gives me great pleasure to talk to items 14.1 and 2. We have gifts and donations. We accept a gift of $518 from Audubon Elementary staff for a backpack program at Audubon Elementary School. And second, we accept a gift of $100 from Ignola and Markensen, Chiropractic Associates, for the backpack program at Audubon Elementary as well. Just to make a quick note, the backpack program, as you can see here, not only is it getting attention at Audubon, it started at Eagleville and has spread to be a contagious and very worthwhile program. And I just want to thank the board for their support, the public for their support, and the businesses in our community for supporting this very important endeavor. It really allows us to reach the children at the most basic level, and that's the level of basic need with food and nourishment. So I want to thank you for your consideration in this matter, and I want to thank Mr. Harney for coordinating that effort within the district among the buildings. So that ends my comments on item 14.
So can I have a motion to approve the gifts and donations as presented in item 14.1? Ms. Barone, is there a second? Mr. Pelicano, any discussion? This is a great program, and we need to thank Principal Brucker, too, for her work in getting this started off the ground.
That was her. It was her brainchild.
Can't thank her
absolutely.
Enough. Okay, if there's no discussion, all those in favor? Opposed? 8-0. All right, item 15, dates for board members' calendars. Please note the following committee meetings throughout October as listed are October 27th, school board meeting at 7 p.m. That will be back at the LGI. I guess two dates to add would be the 10-1 consolidation work, the vendor presentations you're going to see, and also 10-24 homecoming / fields ribbon cutting. So I'd like to have as many folks there as possible. Moving on to item 16, old business, 16.1, PSBA candidate elections. So we have a motion on the table, and so we had a motion for specific candidates last month that was tabled?
We did. We had a motion for
Mr. Miller.
President-elect Mr. Miller, Vice President Mr. Fascinetto, and Eastern at-large delegate Mr. Feinberg.
Okay, so first, I'll ask for a motion to take the elections off the table. Is there a motion? Mr. Phillips, is there a second? Ms. Hackett, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Right, unanimous, so that's off the table. So now, do you want to make a motion?
Well, there is a motion. It's on the table now.
So it's on the, okay, so the motion was made and seconded at the last meeting.
Yes.
So any discussion on the motion to elect Mr. Miller as president-elect, Mr. Fascinetto as vice president, and Mr. Feinberg as Eastern at-large representative of the PSBA? Mr. Pelicano.
Well, I just wanted to follow up, since I was the one who asked for the tabling last time, that I did have a chance to go through and look at the PSBA website, and it has each candidate listed. There's a profile listed. There's YouTube videos where the individuals get to speak and all. And thank Mrs. Woodring for doing her homework well in advance, but I concur with the three candidates that she put forward.
Yeah, I've actually spoken to Mr. Miller before. He was the former president at Centennial, I think, in Bucks County. Mr. Feinberg is one of the circuit riders who is out there pushing property tax reform. Okay, any further discussion? All right, all those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. So Dr. Zerbe, you'll have our candidate election votes submitted to the PSBA appropriately. Thank you. Item number 17, old business, I'm sorry, new business. Is there any new business? Mr. Roth?
Yeah, I'd like to mention a part of something that regarding the high school's marching band. The marching band has gone through extensive rebuilding this year. Last, with the graduating senior class of last year, the band lost approximately half its members, which is any athletic program. If you lose half your team, half your members, that's a huge one. So in other words, that team or that group, half of your members were seniors. And that's a devastating blow to any organization within the district. This year, the band nearly regained, nearly in actually excess, all those lost positions by incoming freshmen. So about 25 new members of the band were introduced. Those freshmen worked for the past 5 weeks to build a new show, to learn how to march, to learn how to play music, which is an incredible feat, considering most of these kids are just 14 years old. Some of them are brand new musicians, too. We recruited people that, for whatever reason, decided not to go for the varsity level sports or the JV in the high school and wanted to try use their musical abilities. It paid off. For the past 2 weeks, the band has been in two competitions and has scored first place in both of them. Things are really looking up for this group, and I just wanted to publicly recognize them for all the hard work that they've done, and also welcome the new band director, Mr. Jeffrey McCoach, who was our elementary band director and who is now the new high school band director and marching band director. And with that, they've replaced nearly all the staff as well within the marching band. So you have a total rebuild of the entire unit, and they are succeeding, which I would like to applaud them for that. Thank you.
Well said. I heard them play a little bit at opening day here when I stopped by there.
And also, I would like to just add that homecoming parade, they will be doing that. And for the first time ever, we're hoping that we might be able to introduce our Arcola students into that celebration as well, because that's where we get the people from. It's going right through the district, and I think it'll be a wonderful thing. Thank you.
They are going to be in there, right? Yeah. So Ms. Lynch confirmed that. So great. Any other new business? Mr. Phillips?
Yes. It's been about a year and a half probably since I've brought up as far as board procedure and announcing executive sessions. And that was, I'd like the board to get in the habit of announcing executive sessions before we go into them, if we're going to have one after the meeting. And then if there's something that we discuss that leads into another topic in executive session, that we announce that in the next meeting. Just to tighten up our how we do business. There's too many times that, for instance, tonight you weren't at the last meeting, you didn't know that they had an executive session, or you forgot. It just tightens that up, and I feel more comfortable going in the back if it's announced prior to us going in the back, and it just seems much more transparent. It's been about a year and a half since I brought that up, and if we can start doing that, I'd appreciate it.
Okay. Very good. Additional new business? Mr. McFarland.
Just one point or question. I think it might be useful to know what the current status is on the Friday-Monday school session with the papal visit.
Good question, Mr. McFarland. We had sent a notice out to parents on Friday, this past Friday, reminding them that we are expecting to have school, a regular school day on Friday and Monday, meaning Friday the 25th and Monday the 28th. We received notice again recently on Monday from Lower Providence Township Police that confirmed that is the direction that they're giving us at this point as well. So what that means for everyone in the public is that we are scheduling, and we have scheduled school for the 25th and the 28th. We, however, also continue to recognize that we may be without choice in changing that
that determination at this moment in time. And that will be dependent on the information that is received from Lower Providence or Worcester Township officials and what's passed on to us as the days progress towards those two days or for the weekend that's ahead of us. So we are prepared as a district to work with Lower Providence Township to provide some transportation if emergency transportation is needed. Secondly, to provide shelter services as our Arcola building is so designated. And we are also prepared to stay in constant communication with them in the instance that, you know, we need to change from the current position that we're on. While you're seeing, a scurry of news within the greater Montgomery County, greater Philadelphia region about schools trying to make decisions related to either, leaving early, coming into school late on Monday, we may still be faced with those decisions. The unfortunate part right now is the township has not indicated that there's a need for any change in our schedule, and therefore we will plan on having a regular school day. But with the instance that our parents should be, and that was the communication, my first communication and the subsequent second communication this past Friday, that our parents should be prepared in the instance that I might have to call a snow day or a delay or a cancellation altogether. That is currently the position that we're in. We will use not only our website, but we will use our school messenger system in the event that has to change to communicate with our parents.
Go ahead, please.
Just a follow-up to that, if we were to have a dismissal, or I should say if we have school canceled, will this be handled just as a snow emergency where it's taken away from spring break, or how will that be handled?
If you're referencing how we would handle it in regards to the whole calendar, you know, how that would impact the calendar, we have prepared what's called an Act 80 day. In the instance that we have the ability to enact that procedure, that allows us to work with our professional staff to provide online professional development for that day in exchange for counting the day. However, the hours, which is the second part of the requirement for schools, we would need to ensure that our hours are made up. And at this point, we are confident that if one day is required to close, we could use that as an Act 80 day and still maintain the number of hours that we need in order to complete the requirement by the state. If 2 days are required, we can certainly do the Act 80 day, but we will run into potential issues. We might be short a few hours that will require us to make some adjustments, particularly at the high school. All the other buildings will be fine with our deductions, but the high school would not. So I just want you to be aware of that. But our goal is to make sure that we stay on target with the calendar so that this disruption, if it should occur, doesn't impact us going into the June months. And it doesn't impact us with respects to our testing calendars and anything else that's before us.
Anything else?
Yes, just one more. If we were to close early or cancel, does that mean all school activities are also canceled, or they would continue as usual?
Typically, on a snow, an early dismissal due to weather, we typically cancel those activities. I would have to have the conversation with my building principals and athletic director, if it's a sporting event per se, to determine whether or not that is required based on the information we have at that time. So we will be making that decision in conjunction with any decision that is either to say that we need to dismiss early.
Sorry, I have a follow-up. Is there any restriction on activities on campuses over the weekend? I just heard that, I don't know if it's probably a rumor, but ARA just canceled all their games over the weekend, and West Norton was declaring a state of emergency. I didn't know if we had any direction to not allow our fields to be used in any manner.
Well, right. There's part of the issue, specifically for Low Providence Township, is that the use of the fields that they have purview over also require that they would need to be able to provide emergency services in the instance that something would occur on those fields. So, for example, if a child gets hurt, falls, hurts an ankle, whatever, and requires medical services, having that requirement in front of them and having known to have to be providing that, at the same time being aware of what's going on with the influx of traffic coming to our region, they just don't want to put themselves and stretch their resources thin on this matter. So predominantly it's centered around closing those areas so that they can manage their emergency services. And we basically will be doing the same thing. So as we review our activities for the coming Friday and into the weekend, we are still in dialogue with other schools related to this issue. And we are taking every precaution to make sure that the decisions that we make will allow all children to get to the event, to get home, and if emergency services are required, they're on site for us for those events.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? Anything else? So I did have one item on new business. To Mr. Phillips' point, I am going to ask the board to go into executive session immediately following this meeting for further discussion on the last item I reported out during executive session, the matter of litigation with Shannondell, so docket 2006-31345. And with that, I'll open the floor to courtesy of the floor.
Good evening. My name is Kurt Reichwein, and I live in Audubon. I have two questions. After the last board meeting, I emailed a question in. 2 days after it was emailed, I received an automated reply stating that this individual was out of the office. They've apparently been out for quite some time, as I've not yet heard anything back about my comments or my question. And secondly, maybe I missed the boat here, but why do we not have an assistant superintendent? I'm assuming that based on last meeting's behavior, I don't expect to get an answer. I get pointed to Ms. Lynch and I have to fill out a magic card. Is that still true this evening?
If you have a question, give it to Ms. Lynch and we'll get you an answer.
Okay.
Bet you I don't.
Evening, Larry Reich, Lower Providence. I wanted to take a few minutes to address the statement that was made at the board's request by the district solicitor concerning the cancellation of courtesy of the floor at the July 28th meeting and the district's response to some suggestion or allegations of Sunshine Act violation in connection with that deferral. So first, I want to say that Mr. Bartle, the district solicitor, is exactly right on the law. And I'm glad that he has advised the board that the only way for this board to cancel courtesy of the floor at a regular public board meeting is by a full board determination that there is insufficient time to hold courtesy of the floor at that meeting. That is absolutely correct. Now, unfortunately, Mr. Bartle's analysis is based on a significant misstatement of the facts that occurred around the deferral of courtesy of the floor on July 28th, which I think would be apparent to anyone who was either in attendance at that meeting or who watched the video of that meeting, which lasted for 45 minutes. And according to the time counter on the YouTube videos posted of every board meeting by the district, it was the shortest board meeting of the year to date. Two explanations were given by the district or Mr. Nascimento for canceling courtesy of the floor, neither of which were the ones that were described tonight by the district solicitor. The first, and the one that was given at that board meeting by Mr. Nascimento, was the absence of four board members. The second, which was given in a statement that was posted on the district's website shortly after that board meeting, and which I assume has since been abandoned by the district with good reason, I might add, was reliance on Section 508 of the school code, which requires a majority of all board members to vote on certain matters. Neither of those explanations that have been given previously justify cancellation of courtesy of the floor under the Sunshine Act, and district solicitor appears to advise you that that, in fact, is the case. The Section 508 explanation that apparently has since been abandoned is a particularly strange one, since Section 508 doesn't actually apply to courtesy of the floor, but does apply to matters that the board did act on, such as the superintendent's pay increase at the July 28th meeting. I think you've been well advised that neither of those prior explanations, the only explanations given previously, support the cancellation of courtesy of the floor. The other problem is that no board action was actually taken to defer courtesy of the floor. This was a unilateral action by Mr. Nascimento, as stated by Mr. Nascimento himself at the July 28th meeting. Now, the district solicitor
Start to wrap up.
I think you want to hear this, Mr. Nascimento, if you'll indulge me for a second. The district solicitor appears to argue that the board acted through the president by not explicitly countermanding his decision. There's three issues there. One, the board was denied that opportunity expressly when it was asked to be put to a board by a member of the public. Second, board policy 002 actually prohibits any one member of the board for acting on the board's behalf. But this is the important thing I think you want to hear. If you accept that version of events, that board action actually occurred in the form of the board assenting to a decision to defer courtesy of the floor, that version of events admits to a separate and independent Sunshine Act violation, because there was no public comment on that board action item at that July 28th meeting. In fact, okay. Mr. Nascimento, you refused to permit it.
I need you to wrap up.
All right. So either way, the board seems to be either admitting to a Sunshine Act violation
or revising history.
You're
past 3 minutes. You're going to have to wrap up.
The point is,
you're welcome to email, but we're done.
The point is,
thank you.
The board's actions suggest disregard for public comment and transparency. Mr. Nascimento, you asked me to wrap up. I'm wrapping up, sir.
Okay.
The board's actions suggest a disregard for public participation and transparency at these meetings, both the cancellation of courtesy of the floor and the story that we heard tonight, the third post hoc explanation of the rationale for that cancellation. The board can and should do better here. And I plead with you, recognize that your public is here to support you. Recognize that your public is here to have input into the process and has meaningful and informed input to offer to you to help you do your jobs better. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The chair has asked me to respond to that because it is an important item and one that has gotten a lot of discussion, I guess, over the last month or so. First of all, I want to talk about the issue with respect to Section 508 of the school code. I think that's a misstatement of what was presented on the website. Section 508 of the school code applied because we did things other than just continue the courtesy of the floor. There were other items that were removed from the agenda, and the response was to the removal of those items as well as to the removal of the courtesy of the floor. Section 508 of the school code was quoted not because it applies to courtesy of the floor, but rather because it applied to the other items that were at issue. And essentially what that section says is that for the approval of certain items, you need not only a majority of those who are present, but you need a majority of the actual seated members of the board. In this case, there are 9 members of the board. It would require a 5 majority vote. That would mean that each of those items that was removed, if they were to have remained on the agenda, it would have required a unanimous vote of those that were here, or else we were wasting our time. Often it is the case that certain items are agreed to by 4 out of 5 members, 3 out of 5 members, or whatever the case may be. Those items were not urgent and need not be approved that evening, so they were removed, and that was based upon Section 508 of the school code. That had nothing to do with the courtesy of the floor issue. Secondly, there is this attempt to impose upon the board the requirement that the board announce why the courtesy of the floor was removed. There is no such provision in the Sunshine Law. It only says that that has to be the board, or in this case, the chair's reason. It doesn't say that that has to be publicly announced, and therefore the fact that it was not publicly announced is not a violation of the Sunshine Law. The fact is also that when the board left the meeting, they went into executive session. Now, common sense is that you can't do both at the same time. And the time that would have been allocated to a courtesy of the floor was therefore allocated to something else, which was the executive session on a matter of importance to the board. The Sunshine Law clearly states that that is a decision for the board to make. Now, if you then take a look at the board's policy, and specifically Section 903, you will see that that is delegated to the chair of the board. It's also delegated to the chair of the board under the procedural rules and Robert's Rules of Order. If you take a look at the school code, you'll see that Section 407 gives the board the opportunity to impose such rules and regulations as it deems necessary and pass those things, and it is on that authority that the policy exists, and on the basis of the policy that the chairman's action was correct. Thank you.
Thank you. Courtesy of the floor.
Karen Vavra, Worcester. Mr. Roth, thank you for mentioning the ban. As someone who lives close to the high school, they had a bit of a start with all their new members, but I love listening to the band, and they are doing a phenomenal job. I've also noticed that in the elementary level, there was a big push for more band members and a program during school hours, which I think is fabulous, and an improvement to the music program. So that's all great, great improvement for the kids. I am struck by Dr. Zerbe's comment that it troubles him that the stadium and auxiliary field does not have lights. Let's be clear. The decision to delay the lights and the extra associated expenses are solely as a result of this board appealing Worcester Township's decision. This board brought the added expense for the community to bear. Your action is irresponsible given the school district's current financial condition. Given that the field project expenses continue to climb, it's incredibly irresponsible. As a participant in the lighting appeal, I'm troubled that you, Dr. Zerbe, as the superintendent, are under the impression that the lighting appeal is solely limited to, quote, safe lighting, unquote. If that's all the appeal is about, I would not be a participant in that appeal. I don't know a single community member that isn't overwhelmingly supportive of safety for our school children. I sincerely believe it's in the best interest of the children for this board to stop hiding behind the thin disguise of safe lighting levels and tell the public your true agenda for this appeal. The appeal and the delay was completely avoidable if this board had simply talked to the community. After Mr. Bartle's dissertation a moment ago on the Sunshine Law, it strikes me, and it's notable, that counsel on this board sits with the board members. I've seen many corporate boards, non-for-profit boards, other municipal and even school boards, none of which the council sits in the seat that Mr. Bartle and his associates sit in. it's very opportunistic that he sits in the middle of the board next to the superintendent and the chair for coaching opportunities. I find it incredible that this board allows that sort of behavior. Thank you.
John Andrews, Lower Providence. On July 28th, I was denied an opportunity at courtesy of the floor. And this evening, I would like to get to speak to what I had planned for that date, as well as separate courtesy of the floor for this evening. Would you agree to that? That sounds to me like a violation of law, Mr. Nascimento. And it again is a lack of courtesy to your public. This is a democracy of the people, for the people, and by the people. And I, along with other citizens here, come to these meetings for the good of the community, for the good of education. And you want us to be quiet. That is wrong. There has been discussion and effort this year on school consolidation, as you know. For years, my cohort survival presentations shared with directors indicated lower enrollments and the need for consolidation due to low utilizations, such as the closure of Skyview that would have other benefits. Then we were presented the Pell Report by an expert that saw never-ending declines. The report was in part based on static housing stock, negligible new home adds, just 2 years of data, and ignorance of resales bringing young families to us. Well, Pell's shortcomings on each of those opinions need pointing out, in my opinion. I note a recent review of projection methods described the Pell method of projections as good for the short term. In 2005, there were resales of 465 homes and the add of new homes totaling 59. The resales dropped to 261 in the Great Recession. New homes were cut in half. Note, it takes 5 years from birth to kindergarten entry. Also, resales have always exceeded new home adds. So I've developed and back-tested a projection model based exclusively on home sales, not births or cohort survival factors, an effort I started in 2009. The Great Recession in housing should end and the student enrollment decline should reverse. I modeled 50 new homes per year and resales rising to 450 per year in the year 2020, both reasonable and not sky high. This housing recovery can be viewed as a reversion to the mean from the slow markets of 2007 through this year. One result is that in 2024, our K-4 enrollment will be 1,840 compared to 1,733 last year and growing year by year. Another result is if the housing sales recovery should not occur, unlikely, my model supports the Pell's simplistic methods decline. I have never suggested an Audubon closure. These comments should dictate extensive and new consolidation study of enrollment, building utilization, and other aspects
John, you of start to wrap up.
Audubon
you have 3 minutes.
Closure decision. Thank you.
Thank you.
Joe Bickelman from Audubon. I was at the July meeting where the courtesy of the floor was canceled, and Mr. Nascimento said it was canceled because there was four board members missing and that he wanted those board members to hear the comments from courtesy of the floor. Mr. Bartle says that the reason it was canceled because of time, because there was a looming executive session that could take a lot of time. Now, you know you're going to go into an extensive executive session with four board members missing. So how important was that executive session that four board members weren't there for that? It seems like we're trying to, you know, we got caught doing something. We better come up with something. I asked two questions today, one about the bills list, about the air horn. So the board members were okay with purchasing an air horn with air canisters for $5,600. I assume that the board members know what that is, but nobody told me what it is. I think a laptop wirelessly connected to the accounting system could get me or anyone from the public answers to anything that's on this bills list. I mean, it's that simple. Not to hear an answer, it makes you think, you know, what the competency level is of getting an answer to these simple questions. The other thing has to do with the advance refunding of the 2009 bonds. I believe Moody's has upgraded the outlook for the district, the financial outlook for the district. I hear that at the Finance Committee meetings. So Moody's is saying that we have a bright future, or a brighter future financially. I think when you refinance, you advance refinance this, the board needs to get competitive bids if you're going out for bonds for this. Put it out on the market, bid it online, because financial institutions are going to want our bonds, and they are going to bid and bid and bid to get the best rate. If it's going out to a bank or banks, put sealed bids out and get these banks, because they're going to clamor for this business because of our good-looking financial situation, according to Moody's. So save money by doing a competitive bid process. I think we use too many consultants. I think, you know, you don't need consultants for enrollment. Administration should do that. Building capacities. Walk around with your building administrators. Look at rooms. Look at what's going on in the rooms. It's very simple. You know, we don't need consultants to point a finger at and say, they told us it was going to be that. You can do this. I'm sure you do this. Also for redistricting, I don't see why you have all the people that are enrolled, all the students that are enrolled are in the bus system. Why couldn't you just draw different boundaries and have the system spit out what the enrollments will be for those schools? I don't know. Maybe it's too simplistic, but I don't know. And I think a capital plan can be put together by the administration, and I think it should be put together by the administration with estimated costs. Those are some of the items I have written down here. I think as far as the activity fund goes,
you can start to wrap up.
Okay. I think a part of the board report should show all the individual club balances that equal the reconciled cash account for the activity funds, so each of the board members can see what the balances are in those activity fund clubs. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Candy Alaba, Eagleville. I'd like to address, Dr. Zerbe mentioned about the test scoring in the school district and how it went down statewide. And honestly, I really don't care about the rest of the state. I'm only concerned about the school district and our test scoring and the fact that you're spending a lot of money on our students, individual students. So I want to see our scores go up. I don't want to hear excuses. I don't want to hear anything. This is a serious problem for the money that the taxpayers are spending. And I'm just curious. I read an interesting article in the Times Herald this week about the superintendent from Springford who was trying to get the statewide superintendent to go to Harrisburg and to rally and to get the state to do something. And I remember it a while back, and I said, you know, why can't the school districts get together and say no to the PISA's increase? Oh, no, that can't be done. Well, unfortunately, the superintendent can only get 37 school districts to go along with them out of 500. That is disgusting, because the superintendent should be going to Harrisburg and fighting for the students in their school districts and bring their test scores up. I don't know where Methacton stood at this, and this point I don't care, but Methacton should be leading the way and getting their parents to go with them to Harrisburg and get the Department of Education to stop mandating all these tests that they're not willing to back up, like the Keystone and the PSAT. All these tests are making our kids raving idiots before they get out of high school. And I see that as a parent who I watch these kids are in worse shape than my children were, and they had a lot of stress. You need to worry about the stress of the students. And I think that's a serious issue. not just along with the parents, the school boards need to worry about this. My other issue is, I attended the meeting in May 14th about the presentation about the crumb rubber and the great discussion about it and how it was going to be plastic coated. And why is it black crumb rubber? I mean, this was an issue. This was a meeting that was not videotaped, and it was brought up about the carcinogens that could affect everyone's children. The coating was supposed to prevent that. Now, it's green. It would be very it would be noticeable if it was green coating being put on the field. Apparently, it's black. Somebody needs to explain this to me, because this was money you voted on to increase it, to change it, to hopefully make it safer for our students. And there's been a couple comments about committee meetings and the minutes not being accurate. I suggest if you're not going to videotape your meetings, get little handheld tape recorders that are voice activated. Tape record the meetings, hand it over to the school secretary. She should be able to transcribe the meeting from the tape if she's a good secretary. And lastly, I'm not going to get in a discussion with Mr. Bartle about the Sunshine Act, because he knows I'm very well aware of the Sunshine Act and what it says, and a lot of laws are open to interpretation. Some people look at it one way, some people look at another. My only issue was when he made the comment about the board following school policy. I've sat in school board meetings for many years, and I have watched the school boards not follow their school policy. And one of them I brought up last night was policy 006. Now I'm looking at policy 903. Which talks about public participation, and it has all the information on the sideline. And one of the things that jumped out at me, the board shall require that public comments may be made prior to each official action. That is not done at these meetings. And as far as ending the meeting early because there was this executive session, I've sat in school board meetings that have lasted 4.5 hours. And have watched the school board leave the room and go into executive session. And I agree that there was 4 members missing from executive session. If they weren't there because they couldn't see the comments, they can watch the tape. You had a quorum, you had 5 people vote. I've attended school meetings, board meetings of 501c3s and everything. And being a regular at school board meetings, the school board, this school board, does not follow Robert's Rules of Order. And it has been mentioned in the past that the school board doesn't follow Robert's Rules of Order. I mean, at one point when Dr. Cooley was here, I was going to buy copies.
Candy, can you start to wrap up, please?
All right. I was going to buy copies of Robert's Rules for Dummies so the school board could read it. But I'm very well aware of the Sunshine Laws. I have not, in the past, mentioned that you have violated Sunshine Laws. I sat there, I kept my peace, and I've taken my note. But you need to read policy 903 and see where you are letting down the public. Because according to 903, we have an expectation of an answer from the board. Thank you.
Yeah, the chairman has just referred the issue to me that Mrs. Allbach mentioned regarding the taking of public comment. And you accurately did read what the section of 903 says with respect to the taking of the action before each item, or excuse me, before the various items are voted upon. That is a provision of the Sunshine Law. And if you read the Sunshine Law, what it says is you can do that in a couple of ways. You can either do that by taking the comment before each item individually, or you can do that by taking the comment collectively before those items. This school district chooses to take that action collectively before all of the items. That's perfectly appropriate under the Sunshine Law. It's perfectly appropriate under the policy. The action does not say, the policy does not say that you must wait for each individual item to come before the board and give a separate call for public comment at that time. So we do it in conformance with the Sunshine Law, and we utilize one of the alternatives that's available, which is in complete compliance with the identical recitation that exists in our policy that is copied from that law.
Thank you. Additional courtesy, Mr. Winters?
Yep. Paul Winters, Lower Providence. Just one quick comment. From a school board perspective, I think the spirit of what the conversation is about openness to have a legal response for every type of question is not helping the transparency, just as a comment. But I have four individual separate questions. One is Mr. Roth proposed in the new business last time, the proposal of a working session. Wonder if that has come up in discussion of the board. I can write the question. Second question I have is, the safety, Dr. Zerbe, you said safely light the lights. So I'm just curious, if we lose the appeal, what does that mean for the safety of the lights we put up? Third question I have is, based on the RFP, you suggested the phasing approach of the RFP, that'll be in two phases. So my question is, will it be the same vendor? And is there a conflict of interest if there's a suggestion that the first evaluation of the enrollment projections could provide additional business around redistricting lines? And the final question I have is, based on that timing of that RFP and the original proposal of the timeline, of the presentations from the consolidation committees in November, if that timeline is still in November, or you plan to propose a new timeline with a new board. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ashley Wilkerson from Audubon. First, I'd just like to say that I'm encouraged by the process that we'll be going through to choose the vendor to examine redistricting, and I hope that there will be lots of thoughtfulness and careful decision-making with regard to the vendor that's chosen for that project. Related to the Consolidation Committee, I'm curious if the membership is still the same now as it was, say, a couple of months ago. It's been relayed to me that Mr. Dowds and Mr. Beck, I believe, haven't been to any meetings since the first meeting, and if that's true, I wonder if there's been any consideration to replacing them with people who will be able to attend the meetings going forward. My next question, or rather comment, is about the list of questions that I emailed to Dr. Zerbe and the board members, which I think most people here are aware of because it was also on social media. And I felt a little rebuffed in the response that I got that we should be individually contacting people and asking these questions and get answers that way. The reason behind that email is because there are a lot of us who show up to these meetings and we ask questions and we wait and eventually we get answers and it's several weeks later. And some questions that we ask, granted, are complicated questions and do require a more thoughtful answer, but the example that stands out most prominent to me was somebody who asked at the last meeting, has the roof at Arrowhead been fixed? And I would quote the response, except there was no verbal response. That audience member was just waved toward the cards to fill out a card to find out yes or no, was the Arrowhead roof fixed? And that leaves us feeling like we're not being heard and like our concerns aren't maybe being taken as seriously as we would like. And maybe that's not the impression that the board wants to give, but it's the impression that we're left with. And that was why we sent the emailed list of questions. And we do appreciate that the time was taken to answer them. But I would offer that maybe we need to find a more efficient way to answer questions so that the community feels engaged. The last point that I would like to make, and I hope I never again have to bring up the Sunshine Act after this, is the response to Mr. Bartle's statement about why the meeting, or why courtesy of the floor was postponed. Because as we were sitting here talking, it occurred to me that I actually have a copy of the email that Mr. Nascimento sent out on Tuesday, July 28th at 11:10 in the morning. And he sent it to Ms. Hackett, Mr. Pelicano, Mr. Phillips, Mr. McFarland, and Dr. Zerbe, and it says, quote, FYI, we only have 5 members present tonight, just enough to make a quorum. If anyone's plans change and they can't make it tonight, please let me know ASAP. In light of the limited attendance, we are going to abbreviate the agenda and only cover critical items we need to approve to keep the district running, for example, finance and human resources. We'll hold the other pieces, reports, courtesy of the floor, policy, etc., until the next meeting. Thanks, Christian. I don't see any mention of an executive session in that email, for what it's worth. But let's say for just a minute that you're right and there were no laws violated and everything was above board. What I would offer is that the best case scenario is still that there was a disregard for the public and our voice. And I would just like to say, whether you agree it was legal or not, let's just make sure it doesn't happen again, because it's not helping the relationship with the board and the community. Thank you.
Hi, Patty Campbell from Audubon. I'm going to leave the Sunshine Act and all that to people who know more than I do. What I'm up here about
Excuse me. Could you repeat your name?
Patty Campbell from
Campbell?
Audubon. Patty Campbell, like in the soup.
Thank you.
From Audubon. My concern is the PSSAs. While I know that they were apparently made harder, and that's all well and good, but are we just teaching our children to take a test? Or are we not educating? I'm a nurse. I can teach people to give a shot, but I can also educate them as to why they're giving the shot, taking why they're doing it, how they're doing it. It's just like our children. We need to educate them, not teach them. Not teach them how to take a test, but educate them to make decisions, to think critically, to have foresight, to look at the bigger picture and think outside the box. This is why our system nationally is not doing well. This is why we're falling behind other countries. This is why, maybe why our school system Effacton is not doing as well as it used to. This is why we're falling and lagging behind Springford and Wissahickon and probably Park Valley at this point. So my concern is not so much the Sunshine Act or what you choose to not do or do, but we need to allow our teachers to educate our children to think outside the box and not teach them to take a test. So next time, when the PSSA comes, it won't be an issue because they will do well because you did not teach them to take a test. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Hackett, I would like to give my second courtesy the floor. And if you object, I would call for a board vote.
Mr. Nascimento said that you were to have one courtesy of the floor. So
That's one director. We have nine directors.
Yes.
Some years ago, Mr. Van Horn allowed a vote.
Excuse me just a moment.
Board policy is
I heard that, Mr. Bartle.
Yeah, I said it loud enough so you would. What I said was that the chair makes the call as to the procedure. If that is to be challenged, it needs to be challenged by a member of the board who calls for the vote, not the speaker who wishes to speak the extra time.
This is Kim O'Donnell, Lower Providence. I'd like to give John Andrews my time.
We don't do that. John, you already had a chance to speak. Let's give someone else a turn.
He can have my time also. He can have mine.
We're not going to do that.
You did it at recent meetings, sir.
No, we did it at a hearing.
No, we didn't. The other person had to transfer their notes.
Okay,
And the speaker.
John, we're not going to do it.
Wasting more time arguing about just letting the man speak.
Yeah, we're not going to do it because then we have to do it for everyone and it's not fair, and so we're not going to do it.
You have to do it for everyone if you do a deferral of courtesy of the floor. When you defer something, you know, in my math, 1 + 1
John,
is 2.
I'm not going to do it, and I'm going to end courtesy of the floor if you don't relinquish the podium to someone else.
Let the board decide.
Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Do we have anybody else that wants to speak? Some of these people are still moving down.
Okay, is there anyone else who wants to speak that hasn't had a turn yet? Okay.
Chris,
John, can you give them the up?
Can we recess and for a little bit?
You can recess at any time, but you have to come back.
We'll come back.
Let me finish.
Okay.
You have to give the people that are lined up to speak in the courtesy of the floor the opportunity to speak. If they haven't spoken already, and I think we had a couple of hands of people that had not.
John, can you please sit down?
Where should I sit down?
You can. Well, that's all the time.
Andrea Reese, Lower Providence. Mr. Andrews, I apologize. I didn't know by raising my hand that we were going to have to stop. I just wanted to bring up that Mrs. Hackett made an announcement at the last board meeting asking us all to be courteous and respectful. And I wanted to acknowledge Dr. Zerbe's transparency and open communication by acknowledging the transportation issues. I thank you for that. I thank you for continuing to work them out. I wanted to give a shout out to the bus drivers because although there were issues, mostly with timing and things like that, there was a couple really nice stories. One was a friend of mine's child left his glasses on the bus. And the transportation office was fantastic. And the bus driver was wonderful waiting on a Friday for her to go in and find his glasses. So I thank the bus drivers and the transportation office for trying their best. Now, having said that, I understand you're all trying to follow protocol and keep things fair. But Mrs. Hackett was somewhat, I don't know how you would put it, schooling us on acting respectful and acting courteous. So please do the same.
Brian.
Hi, I'm Megan Fitzgerald from Audubon. I want to comment on the PSSA test and the amount of time devoted to them. As we all know, PSSA scores across the state have plummeted in just 1 year because of the new tests. According to Dr. Zerbe, quote, results on standardized tests do not provide the sole measure of student achievement, end quote. And from the district website regarding PSSA scores, quote, remember, these results represent only a snapshot in time of student progress on a more rigorous assessment. Methacton's focus is and always has been helping students to reach their greatest potential, end quote. Devoting excessive time to teaching my child to do well on a high-stakes standardized test will not make her reach her full potential. It will, in fact, shortchange her. Students are not using high-order thinking skills or exhibiting creativity by filling in bubbles. I am deeply concerned about the impact a narrowed curriculum and test focus will have on my kids, not only during their school years, but as they enter adulthood and their careers. The consequences are lifelong. I'm not sure what value these tests have other than to rank schools, evaluate teachers, and fill the pockets of the test makers. Our teachers know how well their students are doing. They know what areas they need help in. Our students were excelling before this new test was unveiled. I ask the board and Dr. Zerbe to consider taking a stand and join ranks with area school boards and districts who have said enough is enough. Our children deserve better, and so do our teachers. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian?
Brian Earnshaw, Lower in Providence. A follow-up item from that infamous July meeting. At that meeting, you approved the CFO job description, and I had asked whether or not it could be amended to include a requirement for an accounting or finance degree, and there was a mention it would get referred back to the HR committee or the finance committee. I'm just wondering, is that going to happen, and if not, why? And the second point, it seems like with all the executive sessions regarding Shenandoah and that tax appeal, that's heating up and might be coming to a head. If any of you have driven by that complex recently, you've seen a significant expansion going on. So it's clear that there's value there, and if there's any assessment reduction that they're proposing, I encourage you all to push back hard on that. I know you have a big reserve for that, but that's going to be a huge cash outlay if that goes south. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional courtesy to the floor?
You're welcome.
Sir?
Thank you. Preston Lutwiler, Audubon. I was encouraged to hear that you're having an October 1st public meeting to vet the vendors who will be doing additional work for the district. But I also heard that Thompson Associates is being asked to revisit the capacity assessment, and I'll tell you, I was here in February, and I was amazed at the shallowness of what Thompson Associates did the first time around. So I don't know whether they're on the list of the final three that are being considered for additional work, but I think their first presentation was pretty poor, and I don't think that they should be given a shot to redo what they had already done, which started this mess. Kurt Reichland said that he hadn't gotten responses to a number of questions and comments, and I've been up here several times, left my email address, left written comments, and I have not received any direct responses back. And one of the first questions that I asked back in February was, Audubon was closed in 1984 to 1991. What were the savings, and what was the cost to reopen it, and how was the redistricting done at that time? That should be a blueprint going forward if you're really serious about proposing closing Audubon School. The issue of the lighting. I am still amazed to hear the word safe lighting as if the reason that you don't have lighting on those fields now is because the lighting that had been approved by Worcester would be unsafe. And I just think it's irresponsible to have gone, dragged this out, spent this much money, and had this long of a protracted fight with Worcester Township, one of the communities that you serve. I was here several months ago and talked about the digital sign ordinance that was presented in Audubon. And I was made to feel a little foolish because everyone sitting up there claimed, except you, Mr. McFarland, who admitted that the school board's name was invoked at the hearings that we both went to in Lower Providence, as if you knew nothing about it. And the emails that Ashley Wilkerson unearthed showed you all knew that a proposal and a meeting had been made and money had been spent to advance that sign ordinance, which died in front of the Planning Commission and just stirred up more animosity toward the school district. So when I hear you explain the logic behind closing courtesy of the floor, Mr. Bartle, frankly, I think you were insulting the intelligence of the community that you're serving.
Additional courtesy of the floor? Seen. Can't.
I wanted to address Mr. Ross' comment about the band.
All right, well, let adjourn the meeting, and then you can address it with him directly. I already gave you your time. I can't do it. I'm sorry. I got a motion from Mr. Phillips to adjourn. Is there a second? Ms. Hackett, all those in favor? We stand adjourned.